church of the brides of Christ seemed a thing of the past. Early in 1906, Prophet Joshua was released from prison. He went to San Francisco, but lack of followers there made it hard to be a prophet. The sedate town of Corvallis, with its green trees and blue hills, still appealed to him. Prophet Joshua wrote his ex-father-in-law, "Hurt, God has resurrected me. I've got my foot on your neck. God has given me back his own. I will return to Oregon and again gather all my people." He had a new plan to take up government land on the Oregon coast at a place called Ocean View. The Corvallis-Newport Railroad connected Corvallis with the Oregon coast, and it wasn't long before mothers and daughters, sisters and cousins began buying tickets at excursion rates. Beautiful Esther Mitchell bought a ticket. Not only had she kept her faith, but she worked as a go-between to help Prophet Joshua re-win his divorced wife, Maud. Prophet Joshua dressed his followers in rough cotton wrappers, and the Gant Oregon woods rang with his exultant cry, "Vile clothes be gone, roll, you sinners, roll." Corvallis men lost all patience. One angry husband trailed his wife to Prophet Joshua's camp. In nearby Newport, he bought a revolver. When he spied Prophet Joshua boarding a ferry to cross Aquinnah Bay, he jerked out the gun, pulled the trigger five times, then threw the gun down and kicked it away in rage. The husband had loaded the rimfire revolver with centerfire cartridges. "I am Elijah, the restorer," Prophet Joshua reassured his followers. "No man can kill me." Prophet Joshua took credit for the San Francisco earthquake that rocked the city and nearly destroyed it. He had cursed San Francisco, he informed his faithful, and the same curse lay upon Portland and Corvallis, those towns that had dishonored him. Without knowing it was cursed, Donna Mitchell Starr would probably have left the city of Portland to be with the prophet anyway. Abandoning her sleeping family by night so the crying of her young children couldn't deter her, she left her husband a note and stole $3.50 from his pockets. Of the money, she said, "I think I've been worth that much to you." Donna walked the 90 miles separating Portland from Prophet Joshua's coastal camp, but the prophet had prepared to leave this evening. Coastal residents were hostile toward him and his brides of Christ. They made it difficult for him to lay in supplies his camp needed. Food was growing scarce, and the body of Corvallis men, with lynching on their minds, was said to have set out for his camp. By a circuitous route, Prophet Joshua left for Seattle, Washington. He intended to meet his ex-wife there. Unfortunately for Prophet Joshua, George Mitchell had had a revelation. God willed him to kill Prophet Joshua. It preyed on George's mind that two of his sisters, Esther Mitchell and Donna Mitchell Starr, should be willing gifts for this false divine. George followed Maud Hurt aboard the northbound train to Corvallis. He had a hunch she'd lead him to the prophet. She did. Prophet Joshua enjoyed his Seattle stay. Not only were Maud and he remarried, but he was able to convince Maud's brother to sell his house and property and to donate the money to the new colony. Maud's brother and his family were already on their way to Ocean View on the Oregon coast. Prophet Joshua intended to follow, but first he would buy Maud a new skirt. Her old one appeared quite ragged. On the morning of May 7, 1906, Maud and her prophet set out early for downtown Seattle. They strolled down First Street, listening to the whistle not die, she told the summoned doctor. He can never die. No man can kill him. George awaited arrest calmly. He wired over the herd in Corvallis. I've got my man. I'm in jail here. George. Later, he spoke freely with reporters. I've been looking for Creffield, and I got him, he said. I have no regrets. I'm willing to take any punishment that is meted out to me without a murmur. I did not kill a man, I killed a brute. He obtained a devilish influence over my two sisters and ruined them, and I only did what any true brother would do. One cynical reporter considered George's statement and assumed he had just heard the opening argument of the defense. He was right. The men of Corvallis agreed with George Mitchell's point of view. O.B. Hurt summed it up. Mitchell's well-aimed shot, Bert said, spared others the trouble of sending Creffield to an eternity that he deserved. Corvallis citizens prepared to journey to Seattle, testify on George's behalf, and the Corvallis newspaper volunteered to handle donations directed at defraying his legal expenses. In Seattle, Maud Creffield buried her husband beneath a plain wooden marker reading, Died May 7, 1906, France, Edmund Creffield, aged 35. Held as a material witness to his murder, Maud sat calmly in her prison cell. Joshua will again be in our midst, she said, and Satan will be rebuked. My husband cannot be killed. He is only sleeping. Next Sunday he will arise and become the reincarnation of Elijah the Restorer. Meanwhile, Seattle reporters discovered that whatever prophet Joshua Creffield had been, he had also been a bigamist. He had married once before in Seattle. George Mitchell's open, boyish face and candor won the sympathy of the public. Flowers, candies, jellies, and jams were brought to the King County Jail for him, while at Joshua's camp on the Oregon coast, a handful of starving women tried to exist on mussels and edible plants. They sought shelter with the family of one girl, but her father turned them away. A timber cruiser discovered them accidentally and took word of their plight to the newspapers. O.B. Hurt set out to rescue them. One was his daughter, May, another his daughter-in-law with her five-month-old baby. A third, Donna Mitchell Starr, was wanted in Seattle to testify at her brother's trial. Onlookers jammed the court to watch O.B. Hurt weep on the stand and recount the ways Prophet Joshua Creffield had destroyed his family. The man had gained wonderful powers over his followers, Hurt said. He would keep them rolling on the floor 10 to 24 hours at a time. He made the women burn their clothes and wear their wrappers, and during the rolling ceremonies, even the wrappers came off. 19-year-old Esther Mitchell testified against her brother. Creffield always treated me properly, as he did all of his other followers, she maintained. The charges of adultery raised against Creffield by Starr had been false. Of the prophet, she added, they sent him to the pen to break up our religious camp. Of her brother, she said, he never helped me. I believe he should be hanged. The grand jury failed to agree with Esther. Finding George guilty of justifiable homicide, the jury acquitted him. Spectators greeted the decision with cheers and applause. Men rushed forward to pat George on the back. 2 days later, Esther went down to Union Station to see George off. Hoping she would forgive George, two of her other brothers had suggested a farewell. The light coat she carried over one arm concealed a pearl-handled revolver. She spoke briefly with George. Then, as he turned toward the train, she pulled out the gun. Esther placed the muzzle beneath his left ear and fired. Death was instantaneous. As George had done, Esther awaited arrest calmly. She and Maud Creffield had conspired to kill George. Because it seemed likely Esther would have the best opportunity, she gained the right to make the first attempt. She had succeeded. The police immediately arrested Maud as an accomplice to the crime. He was a holy man, Esther said of Prophet Joshua Creffield. My brother was of the world and defiled. It was right that he should be punished for what he did, but the law set him free. The law determined not to treat George's murderers with such leniency. King County officials found both Esther and Maud insane. Maud died in her jail cell of self-administered strychnine. In accordance with her last wishes, O.B. Hurt and his daughter laid to rest beside her husband, Franz Edmund Creffield. Blame for George Mitchell's death shifted from the still young, still lovely Esther Mitchell to the dead woman. Esther never ceased maintaining Prophet Joshua had always